And I was like, what? How could this be? We're not going to make any money this month. Welcome back to the channel. I'm Lena, and today I am sharing with you 6 things that I wish I knew before starting my Airbnb. If I could go back in time and start all over, I wish I could have said these things to myself before we opened our Airbnb. I'm going to start at number 6. So don't miss my most important tip for new Airbnb hosts, so stick around till the end. On this channel, I make content simplifying money and home, so please subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss any of my future uploads. So my husband and I run a small Airbnb out of our house. We have a 4-bedroom, 2-bathroom house, and we converted 1 bedroom and 1 bathroom into a separate studio with an only outside entrance to run our Airbnb out of. We have been running our Airbnb for a little over a year now, and I want to share with you the things that I just wish that someone would have told me before I started my Airbnb journey. So let's start with number 6. So I wish someone would have told me that this was kind of going to be a low contact side hustle. We don't actually meet any of our guests basically in person. We have met a few of them, or you know, they're driving away and you're waving. But we don't actually have sit-down dinners with our guests. We don't invite them into our house. It's totally separate, and some of them, I don't even know what they look like because I've never met them in person. I wish someone would have told me that Airbnb can be pretty contact-free. So we do the majority of our communication over the Airbnb app. And if they have questions, my husband is our communications boss, and he is taking care of those questions. And then, of course, we're going in there and cleaning and restocking and doing all of those things, but the guests aren't there when we're doing that. So we have guests that we've never seen in person, and I appreciate this contact-free side hustle. This means I'm not dressing up to go meet the Airbnb guests. I'm not showing up and handing them a key every time, because we have a keypad on the door so they can just let themselves in. And then they also don't feel like they're getting any of our germs and they're not in our space. So it's totally separate, and it can be totally separate. And I know if you had an Airbnb inside of your personal house where they were sharing spaces with you, you would definitely meet your guests and you'd probably have a whole another feeling about what kind of people you could accept into your home. But this way, I don't really need to know what kind of people they are because they're not gonna be in my personal space. And I have all locking doors and they have locking doors, and we are just totally separate. The 5th thing that I wish someone would have told me before we had started our Airbnb is that cleaners are hard to find. And I know some people run lots of Airbnbs and they must hire cleaning companies to be responsible for the cleaning, but since we are so small, I normally just have someone we know do it. And the cleaner has to come into our personal house to get all the Airbnb supplies, so I need to kind of know them and trust them to do that while we are gone. Since we do not hire a company to clean our Airbnb, I end up being responsible for training the cleaners, making sure there's enough supplies, making sure they show up, making sure that the quality is up to my standards, all of those things. I have to be involved in that. The scheduling for cleaners when we're away also seems to be a really hard thing to do. It's like, okay, we want to be gone over Thanksgiving weekend perhaps, but then, you know, everybody else seems to be busy on Thanksgiving weekend also. And since this is not their job and they're kind of just doing you a favor to clean your Airbnb, it gets a little tricky and they might be busy also, or they might be out of town also. So that's just something to think about before you start your Airbnb. And coming in at number 4 is that systems help with your Airbnb. So my goal is to have the Airbnb run as seamlessly as possible and to not run into any little hitches while we're trying to clean something. So if we have a system set in place for exactly how we clean the Airbnb, that helps. So as I was preparing to leave and have someone else clean the Airbnb, I created this entire Word document moment by moment about how you clean the Airbnb and what you restock it with. And this has been a very valuable piece of paper for us also as we cling to Airbnb and as my husband clings to Airbnb, because he can just refer to the paper and know exactly what steps are supposed to be taken and how many little coffee pods we need to put in there and all that stuff. So having that reference is super valuable to us, and it also enables other people to clean the Airbnb in the same way that I would have cleaned it. And this is one of those management steps that you have to take if you are going to entrust a job to somebody else so that you can take on different tasks. So you're the boss, you have to give exact steps about how they are going to be cleaning, how they're going to be restocking, so that there's no questions about how the job needs to be done, so that you can have consistency for every single visit. So other systems that we have put into place is our organization of all our extra supplies. So we keep all our extra supplies in our laundry room on this big tower thing. And we've got our shelf for our towels. We've got our shelf for our sheets. We've got our bin of refills. We've got our extra toilet paper over there and all that sort of thing. That is organized and it has a spot. And also, we have enough of everything. So we have lots of extra sheets, and this has been so valuable when you need to turn over the Airbnb fast. We need to have the right equipment, which part of that is having enough sheets, having enough towels, having enough rags for cleaning, having all your disinfecting sprays and all that stuff. So having all of that in order just makes your Airbnb run that much smoother. And coming in at number three, what I wish someone would have told me before I started my Airbnb in my house is that night nurses need to sleep during the day and you've got to think about the noise. So if your Airbnb is not attached to your house, totally disregard this, but if you are sharing a wall or anyone is sharing a wall with your Airbnb, you have to think about the noise level for night nurses. So we love to host nurses, but now we know that we must ask them if they need to sleep during the day, that it might be hard. So I teach music lessons in our living room, which is right on the other side of the wall from the Airbnb, and there is an acoustic piano that gets played, and you can hear it a little bit in the Airbnb. So we had to learn this the hard way by having a poor nurse come and try to sleep during the day, and then we're realizing like, oh, she really has to sleep during the day, but then I have to teach my music lessons during the day, and you can hear the piano over there, and she had to leave and go stay somewhere else because she could hear it and she couldn't sleep. That was such an unfortunate experience, and I don't want that to happen to anyone else. So warn people about what kind of noise they might be encountering if they are staying at your Airbnb, and we specified what times of day that might happen. So on our listing, it says you might be serenaded by some piano or violin lessons during normal business hours, Monday through Thursday. So if they read the listing carefully, they will catch that, but we also try to message anybody who says, yeah, I'm a nurse and I'm coming to town. And so we're always quizzing him, like, do you need to sleep during the day? If so, this might not be the place for you, because there's nothing worse than having an unsatisfied guest because we didn't communicate properly with them. So you can do lots of experiments about how noisy it is over there to see what kind of noises they can hear and what things you might want to avoid, or can they hear a screaming baby over there? And for us, the answer is no. So if the baby is crying, they can't really hear them, even though I still try to move to the other side of the house. If the baby is really having a hard time. The piano, I can't move, so it has to be in the living room, and I don't practice the acoustic piano during the night or in the evening or super morning hours, because we said in that range where they might encounter that noise. So I'm playing my electric piano. So these are just things to think about. And the second thing I wish someone would have told me about running an Airbnb is that there will be lots of canceling. So when we started our Airbnb, I felt very emotionally attached to the fact that we got a reservation. Yay! So excited that someone was coming, and then they would cancel, and I would feel so disappointed about that. But if you know that that's going to happen and people's plans change often, then you're more okay with it. And of course, you can adjust your cancellation policy, and we have the most flexible cancellation policy, and it really does seem to work out okay for us, but that means that people are canceling left and right because they booked their trip without having to plan too far in advance or like be super uber sure about it. But it's super nice for them because they can get all or at least most of their money back, and then someone else can book and everybody's happy. But I didn't know that people would cancel so much. So now my policy for myself is you don't know who's coming until they're here, basically. So our guests can cancel up till 3 p.m. the day before they arrive. So I'm not counting on that guest or that income until the evening before, because at that time, they are totally locked in. But before that, they aren't, and they will cancel left and right. But other people will book at the very last minute. So it doesn't mean if no one's booked that you aren't gonna have a guest. So I'm trying to just not get attached to what the numbers are looking at right now. Like, oh, it says in November we're gonna make $1,000, and we get really excited about that, and then a bunch of people cancel. But that doesn't mean that those days won't fill up later. So I try not to get too bummed out about that. And the number one thing that I wish someone would have told me about running an Airbnb is that there are seasons. So the kind of guests that you will get during the winter months is totally different from the guests that will come during the summer. So this may be different for different parts of the country and for different locations and cities and stuff like that, but this is what we are finding true for us. So during the summer months, people seem to plan farther in advance, which was totally surprising to me. So we have our calendar open for 6 months in advance, and that's as far as we're willing to go. But no one really books that far in advance, maybe a month or two, except during the summer. So we had our first summer this year, and people in like March or April were booking for September. I was like, what? And we were having a baby in August, and I'm like, we haven't blocked that out, but I wasn't even thinking that we need to think about that yet. But people were thinking so far in advance during the summer and wanting to book those times up that they were already taken. So that was kind of cool. And I was like, okay, well, this is the new norm, is that people are booking really far in advance, and our calendar will be like basically full a month or two in advance. But in the off season, that's not true. So during the winter months, people's traveling seems to totally change. So when fall hits and school resumes, people are not planning as far in advance. And I'm guessing this probably has to do with the fact that they're guessing they can book something last minute also. And, you know, we're open so they can. So people are booking more last minute. They're booking for work. They're not booking for a vacation. They're booking to go visit their family. They're booking for a holiday that they're coming to town and they're visiting their family. They're booking during the week for a week at a time because they are on a work trip and they need to travel. So in November, which just got over for us, we have our final numbers for November, but at the beginning of November, there were two people booked for the entire month. And then one of them canceled. And I was like, what? Are we really not gonna make any money this month because we only have those two guests? But it's just because it's the off season and we have been full basically every single day in November, and we're able to pay our entire mortgage with November's earnings. But it all happened at the last minute. And sometimes we would even have weekends open up until the last minute, which is super rare for us because our weekends have been booked pretty much all the time since we've opened our Airbnb. So having an open weekend is like super strange, but they would just get booked at the last minute because someone is making a last minute trip. They were getting their accommodations at the last minute. So I really wish I would have known that, because it can seem really alarming when you're looking at your empty calendar and all summer you were totally booked, and then all of a sudden it's like, no one's ever gonna come again. And that is scary. Which one of these was the most surprising to you? Let me know down in the comments. please like this video so that YouTube knows it's a keeper, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel so that you get notified when my next video comes out. Thanks so much for watching. Hope to see you in the next one. Bye for now.